discuss a few numericals on the network analysis, what we have discussed in the last class with respect to impedance and with respect to admittance, and then we'll enter to the scattering parameters. Okay, so let me take one example for you, which is a simple example. There are three impedances which are connected parallel with each other. Okay, so this is ZA, done. This is ZB and this is ZC, and this is two port network V1 and V2, and the current entering to this is port 1 and this is port 2. Okay, so with respect to this, how to determine the impedance parameter and admittance parameter for this sort of network? Now, as we know, suppose if I am writing impedance matrix for two port network, yesterday we have seen that if it is a two port network, that means four parameters we are going to determine. So first one is Z11, Z12, Z21 and Z22. Okay. Now what is Z11? Z11 is V1 by I1. By making that output part as open circuit like this. Okay. Similarly, Z12 is equals to V1 by I2 at I1 is equals to 0. Z21 is equals to V2 by I1, making I2 as 0. And Z22 V2 by I2 at I1 is equals to 0. So these are the basic impedance parameter for a two port network. Now how to solve this particular value? Now Z11, if there is no current provided at the port 2, your current will move only in this particular loop. So if I want to determine the net impedance in this particular loop, I will get ZA plus ZC, because the total potential is V1, current which is flowing through it is I1, and the total potential will be how much? ZA plus ZC. Okay. Similarly, if it is Z12, if I want to determine as I1 as a V1 with respect to I2, okay, that means only this particular impedance we are going to write, because the current I2 is entering here but I1 is not there. So total impedance V1 by I2 is nothing but ZC. Now, since this particular network is a reciprocal in nature, so we can take this Z12 is equals to Z21. Okay, if Z12 is equals to Z21, that means we will have ZC. Okay, fine. Similarly, if I want to determine Z22, that means V2 by I2, making I1 as 0. That means open circuit for this particular port, and only we are identifying in this particular loop. So in this particular loop, I2 is flowing, but the impedance is how much? Impedance is ZB plus ZC. So these are the simple relations through which we can determine the values. And one more important thing, impedance matching is basically used to calculate for open circuit network. Means open circuit network, here we are identifying with I1, sometimes we are making 0, I2 sometimes we are making 0. So when we are using for admittance part, in that we have to short circuit, because it is with respect to the potential. Short circuit the port 1, short circuit port 2, and then we can identify Y11, Y12, Y21 and Y22. With the help of the same figure, you can determine the admittance parameter. So that is your task, to identify the admittance. So you have to find the admittance matrix for matrices for above figure, means admittance matrix, it is a two port network. You have to determine Y11, Y12, Y21, Y22. Okay, this is your question. This you have to find out. Okay, so this is the simple impedance matrix for the two port network. Similarly, you have to find out what is the admittance. If you know the relationship between impedance and admittance, you can directly substitute it. Y11 is equals to 1 by Z11 and Y22 is equals to 1 by Z22, and Y12 and Y21, it is having certain relation with respect to the impedance matrix, that you have to get it done and substitute the value. After substituting all these values, you will get the admittance matrix. Okay, I am not doing this because this relations already you people have known in the network theory class. So only you have to get it done. The relations are already you have known. Just put the value, relationship between admittance and impedance. So here you can substitute the relationship. Hint is relationship between Z and Y parameter. Okay, so this is the small question for a fundamental operation for the determination of this admittance parameter. So with the help of this relation, you can determine the admittance. Okay, sometime it is a T network they will give, sometime it will be a pi network they will give. So you have to analyze according to that. So here it is a T network, so with respect to that I have determined. If it is a pi network, then analogy will be different. Okay, so one more question we will take. Okay, so this is one more question, simple question. It is a RLC circuit, all are in series connection, and here current is I is flowing across this network, and here we have to calculate, first is power loss, then energy stored due to the electric field and magnetic field. So that is called stored electric and magnetic energy, and the input impedance. Okay, so how to proceed? Now when the word power loss will come, that means power dissipation. Power dissipation will be taken place at the resistive value. Okay, so if I will write power loss, so power loss at resistive, so average power loss, so what I will write, half mod of I square into R, which is equals to PL. Done. Now if you want to determine what is the resistive value, if the power loss is known, then it is simple, R is equals to PL twice PL divided by mod I square. So this is the resistive value. If the power is known, current is known, you can determine the unknown factor. Here just I have represented the unknown factor. Next, what is the electric energy stored? Electric energy stored. So electric energy stored basically in the capacitance, it is half CV square. Okay, so this half CV square is the actual value, but if you take the average value, then what will happen? Average of half C mod V square. Then, so what will be my energy? It is 1 by 4 mod CV square. Okay, so what I will write? Energy stored due to the electric field. Now, if I want to determine what is the capacitive value, then it is 4 times of energy stored divided by mod square of V, potential. So this is my resistive value, This is my capacitive value. Similarly, the magnetic energy, if I want to determine magnetic energy stored, so W suffix M average, okay, so it is half Li square. So this is the basic equation, half Li square, but the average power we are identifying. So here you are getting 1 by 4 L mod I square. So what is the L value? It is 4 W suffix M divided by mod I square. So like this, questions may come. Either you have to represent all the known quantity with respect to the unknown values. So this is capacitance, resistance and inductance. One more important factor, what is input impedance? Now how to determine the input impedance? As you can see, input impedance we can see from this particular point. Okay. Now input impedance means it is the total impedance present in that loop. So total impedance is what? R, L and C. So how to write? R plus JXL, then J divided by omega C. So that we have to write in terms of input impedance. So input impedance is equals to R plus J omega L plus omega C. Like this I can write. It is an input impedance. Now this input impedance we can write in terms of power loss, in terms of energy stored, in terms of energy stored due to the electric field and due to the magnetic field. Only you have to substitute the value of R, what we have got, substitute the value of L from this value, substitute the value of C, what we have got. After substitution of each and every the known factor, you will get PL, power loss, twice J omega W suffix M W suffix E whole divided by half mod I square. So these are the values. Okay, so this will be the input impedance represented in terms of losses as per the given figure. Now this figure I have given in terms of series. The questions may come in terms of parallel. In that case, you have to see how to consider the R value, L value and C value. What will be the energy stored? What will be the, this is the series connection I have discussed. The questions may come in terms of parallel also. So in that case, your input impedance will change. This is for series. For parallel, it will be different. If it is in parallel, you have to go through the admittance first, because parallel connection, admittance is easy to calculate. Then convert into the impedance factor. Okay, so this is the basic relations for determination of power loss, energy stored due to the electric field and magnetic energy stored. Okay, and with the help of that, the unknown factor of R, L and C we have determined, and the input impedance is also represented in terms of power loss, energy stored and magnetic energy. Only substituting in place of R, L and C component. Okay. One more question we will take. Okay. So I have written the derivation. I will explain all this derivation step by step. So this is the third question, and basically this sort of questions in exam they will ask, that how you are going to identify the impedance matrix and the admittance matrix for the pi network and the T network. Okay, so this is one question and this is one more question. First we will discuss this, then with respect to this we will discuss this admittance part. Okay, now as we know that our impedance matrix is having Z11, Z12, Z21 and Z22. Similarly we'll have the admittance matrix also as Y11, Y12, Y21 and Y22. Okay, so first we will discuss with respect to the impedance. Now this network, let us assume it is a symmetric in nature, That means it is a reciprocal in nature, and symmetric and reciprocal in nature. These are the two conditions. Symmetric means you can consider Z11 is equal to Z22, and the reciprocal you can consider Z12 is equal to Z21. This is, I am discussing only with respect to the network, okay, low frequency network. But when you go for the high frequency network, then we are using the scattering matrix. In that case, the impedance and the admittance, symmetric and the reciprocal, are quite similar with each other. Okay, so let me write Z11. So since it is a pi network, Z11 is V1 by I1. So V1, let it be as it is, the total potential across this. First, I want to identify the current I1. So when the current I1 enters, the two current will generate. Here it is I1 dash, and in this case it is I1 minus. Let me write this one. I1 dash, and here the current will be I1 minus I1 dash. And that current is flowing in this particular network. And in this case, when I am determining Z11, your I2 is 0. That means no current contribution in this. Only the contribution is I1 and I1 dash. So with the help of KVL, if you form an equation, you will get I1 is equals to V1 twice of ZA plus ZB divided by ZA whole into ZA plus ZB. If you take this KVL loop, twice the current you have to add. Here it is I1 dash into ZA, first current, first potential. Then here it is I1 dash. When it is coming back, this I1 will be negative, so it will be added up, and then again ZA. So due to that, 2 ZA will come. Twice of ZA plus ZB divided by ZA, ZA plus ZB. So this is the particular case. And this ZC, due to the open circuit, there is no particular connection will be there, no contribution of this ZC. It is only the contribution of ZA and ZB. So this is the, due to the power division method, you can identify these relations. Okay. Next, so V1 will be cancelled out. Take this denominator value to the numerator. So it is ZA whole into ZA plus ZB divided by twice ZA plus ZB. Since it is a symmetric in nature, your Z11 is equals to Z22. Okay. So Z11 is equals to Z22. Next, we have two more unknown factors, that is called Z12 and Z21. If it is reciprocal in nature, Z12 is equals to Z21. So for this, Z12 is V1 by I2, where V1, as you can see, I1 into Z11 whole into ZA plus ZA plus ZB. So when you are identifying the potential 1, so Z11 will come into picture. So total impedance into the current, so Z11 whole into ZA divided by ZA plus ZB whole into I1. So I1 will be cancelled out. You will get, in place of Z11, substitute this value. This ZA plus ZB and ZA plus ZB in denominator, it will be cancelled out. We will get around ZA square divided by twice ZA plus ZB. It is due to the power division method. Okay. So this is my ZA square divided by 2ZA plus ZB. Due to the reciprocal in nature, this is equals to Z21. So Z12 is equals to Z21. So this is the simple relation through which we can directly identify the relations. If the questions are given in terms of some impedance value, directly you can use this relation and substitute the value. Okay. This is the conversion method. Next. If the above condition need to be determined for the admittance. Now how to calculate admittance? So as you can see, I have written Y11 is equals to I1V1 by making the port 2 as short circuited. Port 2 short circuited means potential drop across this is 0. So there is no contribution of ZC. Only the contribution will be ZA and ZB. So here I have written I1 divided by V1 is about potential drop across this particular loop. So how much it is? I1 whole into ZA and ZB are parallel with each other. So net impedance is ZA ZB divided by ZA plus ZB. This I1 will be cancelled out. Your impedance will have ZA plus ZB divided by product of Za and Zb. And if it is symmetric in nature, this y11 is equals to y22. Okay, so this is due to the symmetric in nature. Similarly, for the reciprocal network, if you want to identify, y12 is equals to y21. Now y12 is nothing but i1 by v2, or here I will write y21 so that it is i2 by v1 and v2 is 0. So, and this will be so i2 by v1, what is i2? i2 is minus v1 by zb divided by v1. So in this case v2 is 0. I want to determine i2 by v1, i2 divided by v1. So it is with respect to only zb terms. So it is minus 1 by zb. So y21 is equals to minus 1 by zb, which is equals to y12 if it is reciprocal in nature. So this is the simple relation with respect to the pi network. Similarly, you can determine the relations for the T network also. This is your task to resolve this particular T network. Okay. So this T network is also simple. First, you have to open this circuit. If you open this circuit, no contribution of YC, only the contribution will be YA and YB. So with the help of this, you can determine Y11, Y12, and make as a symmetric and the reciprocal, so that y11 is equals to y22 and y12 is equals to y21, and then you can convert into the impedance matrix. Now how to check whether these relations are correct or not? Now the thing is that when I am determining this admittance and the impedance, if you multiply admittance and impedance, it must be resultant is 1. So if any of this value, if you are multiply with each other, your resultant, if it is equals to 1, then you can justify that yes, my procedure is correct, my resultant values are correct. So let me check for that. So let me erase it first and then we will justify the relations. So as we know that impedance, whether the relations are same or not, impedance matrix, admittance matrix must be equal to the unit value, because Z into admittance must be equal to 1. So here it is Z11, Z12, Z21, Z22. Okay, and here it is Y11, Y12, Y21, Y22. You can check whether your relations are correct or not. If any of this is not satisfying, means you have to redo it. You have to check in which particular point you have made the wrong steps. Okay. So if I will solve this, I will get Z11 into Y11 plus Z12 into Y21. Okay. Then Z11 Y12 plus Z12 into Y22. Okay. Next is Z21 into Y11 and Z22 into Y21. So there are four equations will come. So Z21 into Y12 plus Z22 into Y22. Now since it is a symmetric and reciprocal in nature, so Z11 into Y11, and Z12 into Y21, Z11 into Y12, Z12 into Y22. So if it is reciprocal in nature and symmetric in nature, you have to determine if let us consider this value. Okay, so Z11 we have determined, Y11 we have determined, Y12 we have determined, and Y21 also we have determined. So Z11, let me write Z11 is Za plus Zb whole divided by twice of ZA plus ZB into y11 is ZA ZB divided by ZA ZB, okay, plus z12 is equals to ZA square divided by ZA plus ZB to ZA plus ZB whole into y21 is equals to minus 1 by ZB. Okay, so this is my relation. Now if I want to solve this, resultant must be equal to 1. So let me solve it. So here you can see it is ZA plus ZB whole square, it is twice ZA plus ZB whole into ZA ZB plus ZA square, this minus term will come into picture. Here I will get twice of ZA ZB whole into ZB. Done. Now when you are going to multiply this, your common term is 1 by 2ZA plus ZB. Take this outside. 1 by twice of ZA ZB as common. And here it is, ZA is also common. So here I will get ZA plus ZB whole square ZA ZB minus ZA divided by ZB. Now you have to resolve it. If you resolve it, this ZB will be multiplied here and this whole ZA ZB will be multiplied with ZA. So it will become as a ZA square into ZB. If they open it, ZA and ZB will be there. It will be cancelled out with each other. Let me check. So it is ZA twice of ZA plus ZB. Now inner bracket is ZA square ZB square plus twice of ZA ZB divided by ZA ZB minus ZA ZB. Okay, so when you multiply this, you will get ZA twice of ZA ZB whole into ZA square plus ZB square twice of ZA ZB whole into ZB minus ZA square, okay, divided by, okay, here it is. So take this ZB also common. 1 minute. So it is ZA divided by ZB twice of ZA plus ZB. It is ZA square plus ZB whole square and this is ZA minus ZB, because ZB we have two common, so it is this much. Now ZA divided by ZB twice of ZA ZB, so it is ZA square ZB square twice of ZA ZB minus ZA square divided by ZA. This ZA will be cancelled out. ZA square is also cancelled out. So 1 by ZB twice of ZA, ZB. Here take ZB common, you will get ZB twice of ZA. Okay, because ZB square is common, so you can see that in denominator we have the same value, 2ZA ZB, 2ZA ZB, so resultant is 1. Okay, any of the equation you can consider, and some equations will get as a resultant as 0. So the matrix what we are getting, it is a unitary matrix. Okay, so this is the first. So diagonal element will be 1 and the cross element will be 0, this one. So first we have solved for this. Second equation if you solve, resultant will be 0. Third equation if you solve, resultant is 0. Fourth equation if you solve, resultant will be 1. So these are the simple relation, you have to check it once. In question they will ask, verify the statement, verify the impedance and admittance matrix resultant is 1 or not. So this is the small derivation what I have done with respect to the data what we have generated from this particular relation in this particular network. So we have determined Z11, we have determined Z12, we have determined Z22, we have determined Z21. Similarly, admittance also we have identified, and then we have substituted in this equation. Okay, so here we have got 1. Similarly, for this T network in which admittance is given, so in this also you can proceed as it is, and you can determine Y11, Y12, Y21, Y22. Consider it is a reciprocal and symmetric in nature. And one more important thing, how to convert that Y into Z1? Relations are there, go through those relations. I am not discussing those relations because those relations already you people know in your network theory. Dig it up, form the relation. If you know the value of admittance value, you can convert directly into the impedance value. Okay, so with the help of this sort of relation, you can check again for this network also, Z into Y, it must be equal to unitary matrix. Okay, so this is the unitary matrix. So first equation resultant is 1. We have generated 4 equations. First is this, second will be 0, third will be 0, and fourth will be 1. If you solve all these relations, you will see that we are getting the unitary matrix. Okay. We'll take one more question. Okay, so this is one more question. So here a two port network is driven at both the port. Two port networks are there, such that the port voltage and current is given. So port voltage and current is this much is given. So what are the port voltage and current? Let us consider this is the two port network. This is port 1 and this is port 2. Here we have V1, here we have V2. This is current I2. And here it is current I1. So it is a two port network. Okay. So now, as per the given question, V1 is equal to 10 angle 90 degree volts. Then V2 is equal to 8 angle 0 degree volts. I1 is 0.2 angle 90 degree ampere, and I2 is equals to 0.16 angle minus 90 degree ampere. So this is the given question, and what we have to determine? We have to determine incident reflected voltage for both the ports if characteristic impedance is Z0 is 50 ohm. And one thing I have left, and input impedance at port 1 and 2. So this is the one more question I have given now. So this is the basic factor is given. We have to determine what is the incident and what is the reflected. Now, as we have determined in our wave solution as Vs of V suffix Z of S is equals to, or this is Vs of Z, that is V naught plus V naught minus at Z is equals to 0, we have seen. Similarly, Is at Z is equals to 0 is I naught plus and I naught minus, like this we have written. Now, for the nth port, it is port 1 and port 2 is given. Let me write for the nth port, what will be my incident potential. So, incident potential is half Vn plus Z0 into In, and Vn minus is half Vn minus Z0 into In. So, this is the basic relation what we have determined from the last derivations and all. So, this is my incident and this is my reflected. Now, all the values are given. Now, we have to determine for both the port incident potential and the reflected potential. So, what I will do, in place of n, first I will put 1 and second time I will put 2. So, let me write for the port 1 first. So, port 1, V1 plus is equals to half of V1 plus Z0 into I1. Okay, so here V1 is how much? It is 10 angle 90 degree. So 10 angle 90 degree means it is 10J. Okay, plus Z0 is 50 is given here. And I1 is how much? I1 is 0.2 angle 90 degree. So that means it is J.2. Okay. Is J.2. Now when you will solve this, you will get J10. So 50 into 0.2, it will become as again J10. So it is J20 divided by 2, you will get J10. So it is 10 angle 90 degree. So this much volt is the for port 1. V1 plus is equals to 10 angle 90 degree volt incident potential. V1 minus is half V1 minus Z0 into I1. Here I will substitute again J10, done, then minus 50 and J.2. Now this J.2 into 50 will become 10, so J10 minus J10 resultant is 0. So that means reflected potential at port 1 is 0. So incident is 10 angle 90 degree and reflected potential at the port 1 is 0. Similarly, we need to calculate for port 2. Now for port 2. So port 2 is V2 plus half of V2 plus Z0 into I2. Okay. So if I will substitute what is V2? V2 is how much? 8. Angle 0 means real factor. Z0 is 50 and I2 is minus J.16, because minus 90 degree, so minus J will come. So 16 into this 50, 16 by 100, this is 2, this is 8. So here I will get half 8 minus J.8. Okay, so that means V2 plus is 4 whole into 1 minus J. So this much is the volt for the port 2 incident potential. So if you want to write in terms of polar form, you will get around 5.65 angle 45 degree. So V2 plus is equals to 5.65 angle 45 degree. Then similarly, for the reflected potential, V2 minus half of V2 minus Z0 into I2. So here only the difference is plus, now it will become minus. So minus minus will be plus. So here directly I am writing, this is minus 45 because it is minus is there, 1 minus J, and here we will get 8 plus J 8 or 4 times of 1 plus J. So 5.65 angle plus 45 degree. So this is my reflected potential and this is my incident potential. Over. So like this you have to calculate the incident potential and the reflected potential for the port 1 and port 2. Next, one more question is left, that is, what is the input impedance at port 1 and port 2? Let me write. So input impedance at port 1, so that is V1 by I1. So V1 is how much? 10 angle 90 degree. And what is I1? It is 0.2 angle 90 degree. So this 90 will go up, so 90 minus 90, it is 0 degree. So it is 100 by 2, we will get 50 ohm. So input impedance at the port 1, we will get at this 50 ohm. So it is 50 ohm. Similarly, input impedance at port 2, that is V2 by I2, V2 is how much? 8 angle 0 degree. I2 is how much? 0.16 angle minus 90 degree. So this angle will go up, minus will be there, so minus minus will be plus. So we will get 8 divided by 0.16 angle 90 degree. Now how much it is? 8 into 100 divided by 16 angle 90 degree. This is 2 and this is 50. So it is 50 angle 90 degree ohm. So input impedance at port 2 is 50 angle 90 degree ohm. So this is the input impedance for port 1 and this is the input impedance for port 2. So like this question will come in your exam. They will identify that what is the relations you have understood and with the help of those relations how you can solve the given question. Okay, so this is more about the impedance and admittance. Next we will see what are the other parameters are there and how that scattering parameter will help us to why we are going the scattering parameter for the microwave network, not with this impedance and admittance matrix. Okay, that we will discuss now. Okay, so here till now we have discussed about the low frequency network. Now as we know that the microwave frequency are range from in gigahertz, 3 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. Now in that particular frequency range, this normal Z parameter and Y parameter is unable to determine. It is very difficult to determine. Okay, so it is very difficult to determine the values of Z parameter and Y parameter, even hybrid parameter and ABCD parameter. As you can see, I have written few parameters. Okay, this is first one is the Z parameter. I have considered this is all for the two port network. Here you can see the two port network is available, this two port network can be a transmission line also. Two wire line will be there. This particular part is the generator side and this one is called the load side. Now the thing is, there are two sources are available, two currents are available, then we can determine the Z11, Z12, Z21 and Z22 for the two port network. Similarly, admittance part also you can determine. Even we can determine the hybrid parameter also, which is relation with respect to V1, I2 and I1 and V2. Similarly, the transmission matrix also we can represent with the help of ABCD parameter. These all parameters you have known from the network theory. Just I am giving a glimpse of it, why this is not utilized in the micro frequency range. There are certain reasons are there. Now, first of all, first thing is that whenever we are discussing about the component with respect to length of a particular device, okay, so if the length of a particular device is very less than the wavelength, that means it is working in a low frequency component. If you apply the high frequency component to the device, it will not work, it will not take any, we will not get any sort of outputs, okay, it will give all sort of wrong information to us, we cannot calculate the exact values. So if you are working for a long distance, if the length of a device is means more than is greater than wavelength, then that particular device can be used for the microwave frequency. So the first condition I have written, the length of a device is L and it is very less than the wavelength. If it is very less than wavelength, means it will operate at a low frequency. Now in low frequency means small circuits which can identify through which we can identify these parameters: impedance parameter, admittance parameter, hybrid parameter, as well as ABCD parameter or transmission matrix we can identify. But when this particular low frequency circuit, if you apply a high frequency, it will not give the exact value. All wrong informations you are going to identify. For that, what is the theory says, if you increase the length, if the length of the line, as I am telling that your transmission line length is 100 meter, 200 meter, 1 kilometer, if it is like that, then it will work at in which wavelength is less with respect to the length and it can operate at a higher frequency. Good example is a telephone line. The length is very much high, which is greater than the wavelength, and it operates at a high frequency. Okay, so similarly, our microwave frequency also we can identify with the help of this same analogy. So there are few reasons why these Z parameter, Y parameter is not used to determine the high frequency circuit analysis. Okay, when we are using for high frequency circuit analysis, we have to go for the power calculation. We have to go for the power relations. If the power relation, as here it is with respect to potential and current, in that case we have to relate with respect to power, incident power, reflected power, and what is the output power, and we have to form relation between that, and those relations are called as our scattering parameter. Okay, because power is going to scatter throughout the medium. So when the power is going to scatter throughout the medium, we have to identify the power with respect to the normalized component. And those normalized components are nothing but our scattering parameters. Okay, it also represents the same matrix. It is a square dimension and all that we will discuss in the next class. But for today we will discuss the why these parameters are not going to be feasible when we are going for a higher frequency calculation. The first reason is the non-availability of a terminal voltage and current. Okay, now terminal voltage and current we are identifying at the port, but when you are going to identify within the device, it is very difficult to identify in the high frequency. Only the frequency is going to carry your information. In that case, how it is very difficult to identify, in that case the power is going to be identified, and in that case the potential and current at, with respect to the position is very difficult to identify. So for that reason, this Z, Y and all these parameters is not going to be feasible if we work in a higher frequency range. Okay, so that is the first. Second, the short circuit and the open circuit are not easily achieved for a wide range of frequency. It is very difficult. Okay, so short circuit and open circuit is only possible to determine this parameter, because sometime here if I want to determine Z parameter, means I have to use through open circuit nature. If I want to go for Y parameter, I have to go for short circuit in nature. But when we are working in a high frequency component, it is very difficult to design the short circuit, and the open circuit is not feasible to design this sort of network when we are operating at a high frequency transmission of information. Okay, so that is the second reason. And the third most important reason is the presence of active network. The presence of active network between the source and the load, due to which it is very difficult to design the short circuit and open circuit network, because the device which we are going to use, few devices are active as well as some devices are passive also. But when we are using the active network for the communication purpose, in that case the short circuit and open circuit is very difficult to design. So these are the basic reason through which we can understand why these parameters are not feasible to calculate the data for microwave range. But we can form a relation. If you know the power relation, you can determine the potential and current easily, but with some limitations are there. Some conversions you have to make it. So as we have made a conversion from Z to Y, Y to H, H to, and all these relations are there. Similarly, scattering parameters can also be represented in terms of impedance, can also be represented in terms of admittance, theoretical calculation. Okay, so all relations are there. Those relations and the properties on which it depends, the scattering parameter, that we will discuss in the next class. So for the time being, we'll wind up the session. Tomorrow we'll continue with the scattering parameter. Thank you all.